Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The parable of the talents from our gospel reading has had a long and storied history in America. Early in our history, this parable was used against America. Preachers in England saw the Puritans as the unprofitable servants, declaring that as they immigrated to America, that God was casting them into a land of darkness where there would be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Later, however, this parable was used in favor of America. Revivalist preachers declared that America was a place of opportunity where profitable servants would be blessed. Faithful stewardship, they said, would result in financial prosperity. In fact, in the 1920s, Sinclair Lewis wrote a social satire of such preachers in the way they used this parable to proclaim the cash value of Christianity. Well, the truth is, even today we continue to struggle with this parable. But our struggle is a bit different. America challenges us with the way that it imagines God and the way it tempts us to misvalue God's kingdom of heaven. His preaching does, however, well, in this parable, Jesus is not talking about America. Instead, he's talking about the kingdom of heaven. His preaching does, however, challenge us as Americans and our misconceptions of God's kingdom. Jesus does not invite us into a world of earthly gain and riches, but instead into a world of divine love, where faith responds with joyful service. When the Master returns to settle accounts, Jesus wants you to hear, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Master." But what does it mean exactly to live in the joy of the Master? Our readings today, they all turn our eyes towards the last day, towards the end times, and the vision that we hear in all three readings is rather horrifying. In Zephaniah, he describes a day of wrath and distress and anguish, a day of ruin and devastation, of darkness and gloom. And even St. Paul gets in on it, declaring that that last day would come like a thief in the night, when there will be destruction and darkness. Such horror, however, can cause us to overlook the most horrifying detail of all. You see, in the parable of the talents, the cause of the unprofitable servant's damnation is his own imagination. You see, the unprofitable servant, he chooses to live with a master that he has imagined rather than the master who has revealed his generous love. In the parable, Jesus tells us of a very generous master, one who gives all that he has into the hands of his servants. And the amount that the master entrusts is absolutely astounding. A conservative estimate says that just one single talent was worth 20 years of daily labor. And later, the master says that this was only a little, as he sets his faithful servants over much, much more. But the unprofitable servant, he lives with the illusion of a different master, a harsh and cruel master. For him, the master was a hard man, reaping where he did not sow and gathering where he had scattered no seed. And this has the servant living in fear. It paralyzes him, so that he takes what has been entrusted to him and he goes out and he buries it for safekeeping. When the master returns to settle accounts, He judges the servants according to what they have believed. As the servant believes, so it's done to him. And because the unprofitable servant did not trust in the loving generosity of his master, that servant is cast into the outer darkness, where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. Jesus has come to show us the love and the generosity of our Heavenly Father. His Father's love is not measured in the amounts of money that we are given, but instead in the life and death and resurrection of His one and only Son. Jesus brought into this world a love that was absolutely priceless. A love that does not balk at the cost of sin. A love that would suffer death and even eternal damnation so that the debt of all of humanity would be paid. But unfortunately, there are far too many people in our world who turn away from this revelation of our loving Master. Such love to them seems brutal and violent, uncivilized, and they would rather live with the God that they imagine rather than the God who is revealed by Jesus Christ. The God they imagine, however, is not hard and demanding and someone to be feared like the unprofitable servant imagines. No, the American imagined God is all-loving. He is kind-hearted, like a grandfather, too weak to really do any harm, but still strong enough to love us. Instead of repentance, this imagined God calls for tolerance. Instead of forgiveness, this God offers acceptance. So turning from sin and being forgiven, it seems very strange in America today. Why in the world would we in the Lutheran Church, why would anyone in the Christian Church continue to talk about sin at all? I mean, after all, nobody's perfect, are we? And God is, after all, love. And so people in our world, they imagine that they can stand before God with all of their sins and be accepted for who they are and for what they've done. But unfortunately, this God is simply a figment of the American imagination. And in the end, this imagined God will not and cannot save. God saves us not by our imagination, but by His action. In Jesus Christ, God has entered into our world and He has acted to save us. His love goes far beyond our wildest imagination. He saves us not by becoming what we want Him to be, but by becoming what we need Him to be, a Savior. Our Savior, He knows the very real danger of sin, and therefore He calls us to repentance. Our Savior, He knows the eternal cost of our sin, and therefore He dies our death and suffers our punishment. But our Savior, He also knows the eternal joy of salvation, and so He rises again. Not to tolerate sin and to accept sinners, but instead to forgive the repentant and to invite them to live in eternal joy. And so living in the joy of the Master means turning away from our imagined American God and instead trusting in the God that is revealed to us in Jesus Christ. The very Son of God who gave His life so that we might live in eternal joy. But living in our Master's joy means even more. You see, it also means serving as people differently gifted, but equally loved. You see, while one servant fears the master that he has imagined, the other servants trust the master that they know. Their master is a very gracious and a very generous man. Instead of harshly ruling over them, he graciously rules through them, giving them his great wealth for service in the world. He divides his possessions between them, each according to their abilities, and then sends them forth as servants who are differently gifted, but equally loved. Each servant is loved. He is a part of the household of a very generous master, and yet each servant is differently gifted. One receives 5 talents, another 2, and another 1. Well, the fact that the master gives to each servant differently often causes us trouble. It looks as though God does not love everyone equally. You see, in our consumer-based culture, we associate having more with being better. So obviously, the servant who has 5 talents is better off than the servant who has 2. And in our profit-driven culture, we associate making more with being better. And so the servant who makes 5 talents is thought to be better than the servant who only makes 2. Well, such attitudes, they cause us to divide ourselves into those whom God loves more and those whom God loves less. And unfortunately, even some of our churches do the same thing. For example, some churches emphasize service to the congregation as more important than service to our vocation and our family. A member who teaches Sunday school and sings in the choir is honored as being faithful, whereas another member who works as a single mother and raises her children faithfully is thought to be of less value. The master, however, he receives both servants with joy. He tells them, "Well done, you good and faithful servants. Enter into the joy of your master." God's love for us, it delights in our differences and it rejoices in the various ways that he has equipped us for service. As St. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, if the whole body were an eye, where would the sense of hearing be? And if the whole body were an ear, where would the sense of smell be? Our service to God, it does not earn us a place in his kingdom. God has already freely given us that through Jesus Christ. And yet this same God who loves us all equally, he also delights in our differences. He values each and every one of us, and he values our different abilities, letting us know that our service, no matter how great or how small, brings him great joy. And so living in the joy of our master means rejoicing in the various places that he has called us to serve and in the various gifts that he has given us for that service. In service to God, we manifest an infinite variety of his goodness as we serve one another and our neighbor. And so living in our master's joy, then, it does not mean comparing ourselves to one another to see how well we're doing. And it doesn't mean dividing ourselves from others as though God loves some of us more and others less. Instead, it means trusting in what God has revealed to us through Jesus Christ, that he loves all of us equally, and then faithfully serving in the various places that God has called us to serve. We are differently gifted, but we are all equally loved. Enter into the joy of your Master. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Amen.